So let's bow down, have a word of prayer before I start my message. Hallelujah. Our Father, gracious Lord, we come before you with thanksgiving for everything and everything that is happening in our life around us and that's going to happen. As I come here prepared to share your word, Lord, I pray, let your wisdom be upon me. Let your understanding be upon me. And we pray that as I share your word, Lord, let our hearts be open and receptive. And let the Holy Spirit make the word understand to each one the message that you have planned today. We thank you and bless you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let me share my screen. Okay, basic I have, no, computer share screen, advance. And I'm not getting the set one, okay, fine. Share. Stop share, 1 second, I'm having advance and I'm not getting content from the second camera music, okay. I'm unable to, so I'll share it fully. Fine. So here it is. Let me minimize it. Perfect. You know, if I can take you all back to the December of 2019, and when we met for Christmas. Praveen, are you able to see the PPT?
We are able to see Sachin.
Thank you. Yeah. So as we gathered for the Christmas service for 2019, I think many of us had a plan, like to-do list in 2020. We want to do this. We want to be here. And we had a perfect list that 2020, I'll be here. 2021, we'll do everything. As if the life was set and we had our priorities set on what we want to do. But at the same time, little did we know that there was a novel virus called Corona, which was slowly spreading within the bounds of Wuhan. And within the span of 3 months, the virus spread worldwide. Our businesses, our life, our work, our economies, all were impacted. And impacted to such a level that everything came to a sudden stop. And our lives were in lockdown. And in the last time when I shared about the new normal, I've shown you the empty streets worldwide. The whole world was waiting for this pandemic to end and our new, now old normal lives to start. And some glimpse of hope came when the European nations started saying, oh, we achieved the flat curve. We are going on a reduction site. We are opening our economies. And India thought, wow. Even before reaching our peak, we said, wow, we know what to do. We opened up our economy. But then entirely opposite happened. The virus spread more vigorously and more dangerously. Today's situation is worse. The virus is no more at some different place, but it is right in our neighborhood. It's reached our families. And while all this is happening, everyone around the world are crying out to God. The Christians worldwide are praying, fasting, and pleading with God. We are all crying to God to hear our prayers. And all we want from God is to drastically end all this. And in all this chaos, the media news, they are shouting of what's going to happen, when it's going to end, everything. And in all that chaos, we are unable to hear the voice of God. And sometimes we wonder as if God is not paying attention to us. He seems so silent in answering our prayers. And we assume that he is answering our prayers with saying, wait, wait. And I think today, we would like to pray, how long must we wait, God? How long? Things are so worse, but how long, God, you want us to wait? Now let me take you one such episode from the Bible, from John chapter 11, verse 3 to 6. And I just, Sangeeta read. And I'll just take, notice the word I have highlighted. When Martha sent the message, he says, Lord, behold, he whom you love is sick. He whom you love is sick. So she is conveying, you love us and one of us is sick. And in verse 5, notice, now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. John writes that Jesus reciprocated the same love. But then in verse 6, he says, so when he heard that he was sick, he then stayed 2 days longer in the place where he was. Now just imagine what's happening in the minds and hearts of Martha and Mary. He loved us. He know we love him. Whatever he is doing probably can wait. Can't he just stop ministering to other people and just come at once and help us? And all this is going on in their mind. But Jesus doesn't come the same day, doesn't come second day. After 2 days, he decides to come. And when he arrives there in Bethany, he starts speaking with them and not addressing the issue immediately. And the same question here we have today is that why God is not getting involved in our situation that is happening around the world. It is true that the world is praying. It's true that the churches are praying. It is true that the people are fasting and pleading that the pandemic may pass and go away. The loss is enormous. We received pay cuts, lost jobs. People are going into depression that is causing them to commit suicide. Children lost their chance to be with their friends and stuck into the online means for study and living their life. The domestic abuses cases are on rise. We lost our loved ones. The question then on top of our priority is how long, God, how long must we wait? And in the Bible, there are three such occasions, including this one in the book of John, that you see that Jesus used this approach. And in John chapter 2, verse 4, when Jesus' mother, Mary, comes to him and said, in the marriage, the wine is finished. Can you do something about it? And he says, my hour has not yet come. Now just imagine things from his mother. Marriage, wine is finished, guests are there. Boy, this is the time. But Jesus says, my hour has not yet come. Then you go in chapter 7 when his disciples are going visiting Jerusalem for Feast of Tabernacle. They ask him, Rabbi, would you like to come with us? He says, you go ahead. My time is not yet here. And let me give you one more incident from an Old Testament. In the lives of Israelites, when God frees and takes the Israelites out from the clutches of Pharaoh from Egypt, he brought them out of Egypt. And as they are starting to enjoy their freedom, they come across Red Sea, where the sea is in front of them, and they see Pharaoh's army approaching them. Now they are in a kind of impression that God has rescued us. So ideally he is not supposed to bring in another such trouble because he had just rescued us. And when they see the slowly the Pharaoh's army are approaching, they lose their patience and then they start the blame game. But how did God responded to this situation? If you see in Exodus chapter 14, verse 13 and 14, Moses answered the people, do not be afraid. Stand firm and you will see the deliverance the Lord will bring you today. The Egyptians you see today, you will never see again. The Lord will fight for you. You only need to be still. You only need to be still. The Lord will fight for you. Now, if you see the situation today, the answer for God is same. Wait, 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 and see the deliverance from the Lord. But again, waiting, what is this wait? What does this wait even mean? Does it mean that I give up everything and sit idle? I did my job. Or does it mean to have any part to play in this whole waiting game? You know, the author, Christina Fox, in her article, Three Things You Can Do While Waiting on the Lord, she says, waiting doesn't necessarily entail idleness or sitting still. In the Bible, waiting is a posture of heart. It's a humble reliance upon God who rules all things and holds all things together. It's living out the knowledge that God is good and faithful and will always be so. Biblical waiting requires hope and trust in our steadfast God. Let me give you one small testimony. In the last week when we are having our Bible study, one of our friend, they are a young Christian couple, both husband and wife are Christian, raised up in Christian homes. They said, Sachin, I feel so powerless that every time, everything we have to give in God's hand, I have to just wait. I said, so Betsy, what's wrong? Do you think that God is, your decision, if you have to take, would be better than God? She said, no, God's plan has always been good. And I said, what's your problem? It's just that we have to wait. For everything, we have to wait. And then I realized, oh boy, it's the human problem of waiting. We are so used to having instant result, Amazon same day delivery. Everything is so instant that waiting is difficult for us. Waiting is always been difficult. We know through our life and testimony that God's decision has been good, but we want God to act now. We are praying, you act now. We are pleading, you act now. We are fasting, you act now. So let me tell you, I share with you five things of what God expects when he tells us to wait. And the first thing he says, retreat, withdraw, fall back. Now what does retreat mean? The dictionary meaning of retreat is withdraw from enemy forces as a result of their superior power. And when you see the circumstances are overpowering you, it's time for us to retreat back to God. Now today God wants us to retreat, fall back to him to gather more strength to fight these circumstances. See, in Hosea chapter 12 verse 6 says, so you by the help of God return, hold fast to love and justice and wait continually for your God. Return. And then hold fast. Come back, align yourself vertically with God. If you see in Psalm chapter 24, 27, verse 4, it says, wait for the Lord. Be strong and let your heart take courage. Yes, wait for the Lord. What we are doing in retreat, be strong. Let your heart take a courage. And then bounce back. Wait on the God. Now, you cannot retreat back and gather strength to fight the enemy if you do not believe on the source of your strength. The source of our strength is God himself. To believe in God, you need to know him. You need to have a very personal relationship with him. But how do you know him? You know him when you read about him in the book of life. You know him when you are in communion with him, constant touch with him. You know him when you have faith in him. And Romans 10 verse 17 says, so then faith comes by hearing and hearing the word of God. Seek him. Increase your faith. Now, Michael Ramsden from RZIM Ministries, he says, faith is knowing that God is real and that you can trust in God's promises. That's faith. Now, you cannot trust someone who isn't there, nor can you rely on someone whose promises are not reliable. And that is why faith is talked about as the substance of things hoped for and as the evidence of things not seen. Yeah. Both, and he continues to say, both words carry with them a sense of reality. A hope is not a wishful thinking. Faith does not make God real. On the contrary, faith is the response to a real God who wants to be known to us. Wow. So we need to know him to increase through our increased faith. Second thing, seek him. When you're waiting, you seek him. You seek him in prayers, through Bible study, through fellowship. You seek him. We don't cut our communication lines with God when we are waiting. And when we hand over our battle to him, it's not a one-sided battle that either you or God is supposed to battle. During the time of wait, seek him more earnestly. Communicate with him. Share with him what you feel. Because he, when waiting, he wants to know how you're going through. He wants to strengthen you during this time of waiting. He doesn't expect you to go alone through this journey. He is not a God who is distanced with us in our time of waiting. And let me give you one promise. In John chapter 10, 29b to 30 from the Bible version message, it says, no one can steal them from out of my hand. The Father who put them under my care is so much greater than the destroyer and thief. No one could ever get them away from him. I and the Father are one heart and mind. Just imagine if the Father and Jesus are one in not letting us go through this alone, it's implicated that the Holy Spirit is also with us, strengthening us in this journey. And as our triune God is perfectly united, and his Spirit is our helper, is a counselor, and a companion in this waiting line. Amen. We are not alone, even in the waiting time. Third, count your blessings, using your past as a evidence of the hope in waiting. Now, this is the most important thing and the best thing you can do. You're waiting, things are not happening. Look back into your life. Look back into life, and every time when God has come to your rescue, every time that God has delivered you, start counting your blessings. And I'm telling you, your wait will be over faster than you will ever have a time to count your blessing. That many times God has rescued us. Count on him. Look back. Gather strength from your past blessings. Number four, rework on your priorities. Now, while we are waiting on God and as God is working behind the scenes, this is a good time to work on our priorities. What are your priorities, church, today? I know we had a very busy life before lockdown, and our priorities were filled with things which are so unimportant. But today now we have plenty of time in this waiting period. Let's prioritize our lives. I want to ask you some question. How is your relationship with your parents? When was the last time you called them and checked upon them and to know that they are going good? Spend some more time with them. Let them know that they are cared for, that they are often remembered. Is your spouse is still the best person in your life? Does your action every day replicate the same message? Work on your relationship. There's plenty of time. When was the last time you followed up on your family or your relative or your friend? You called him up and checked, hey, what's happening? Mind I tell you, I'm not talking about WhatsApp forward, that same message we forward or encouragement or Bible verses. I'm talking about take a phone, be involved. Let your voice be felt. Let your touch be felt. Rework on your priorities. Next thing, help others. I tell you, there's nothing in the time of waiting that is to keep ourselves busy by helping others. Now, God has given us unique gifts and talents, and he expects us to use it to help each other at all times. And especially in the time of this waiting, instead of just sitting idle and waiting, something will happen today, tonight, tomorrow, get up and use your gift. Help somebody who is in need. You know, in Galatians chapter 6, verse 2, it says, carry each other's burden. And in this way, you'll fulfill the law of Christ. It is expected out of us to carry each other's burden. So get up and do those things, even in a small, small level. And carry each other's burden. Be the part of the process in this waiting. In conclusion, you know, in difficult time as this, we all need each other. And each of us has something that we can be of help to our family, our neighbors, and our friends. I want to ask you, do you think it's too difficult to wait? And you feel that you're losing out on this battle? Let me give you God's promise. In Isaiah chapter 46, verse 4, it says, even to your old age, I will be the same. And even to your graying years, I will bear you. I have done it. And I will carry you. And I will bear you. And I will deliver you. Amen. What a promise we have. What a promise we have. But do you find it difficult in this time of trouble to stand on God's promise? It's okay. We are just human. And God knows that. And that's why He gives His Holy Spirit to strengthen us, to look and stand on the promises that He has given us. In Galatians chapter 5 verse 5 says, but we who live by the Spirit eagerly wait to receive by faith the righteousness God has promised us. Wow. Even He gives His Holy Spirit for us to look forward to the promises He has made us. It's His righteousness and faithfulness that would help us to endure and exercise our faith in this time of waiting, to see His glory being revealed. So even in the times of waiting, God doesn't want us to go it alone. He has given His Holy Spirit who would walk with us each and every step. And I want to share as we conclude one song that has helped us as a family during our time of waiting. It has lifted our spirit. It has pushed us to do action. Let me share that with you. Voice is audible?
Yes, it is.
Thank you. Let's bow down and close with a word of prayer. Gracious Father, what an amazing love you have for us, O Lord, that even in the time of waiting, you are with us, walking every step, telling us, confirming us in our hearts that you are still in control and that you are able, more than able. So today we bring everything in every area, in every item of our prayer, in that we are waiting for you, O Lord. We will wait because your decision is better than us. We will wait because your timing is perfect. And while we are waiting, O Lord, we'll not sit idle. We'll work our faith. We'll retreat back. We'll increase in our communication with you, O Lord. Will be a blessing unto others, O Lord. So give us strength today. We thank you and bless you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.